السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله إن الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وختام النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا أما بعد. I'm going to tell you tonight about my journey from where I once was as a former Christian youth minister to how I got to where I am now. There's a lot of bumps in the road, you know, it seems pretty clear, yeah, you're a minister and now you're a Muslim, you know, but there's a little bit more to it, inshallah, so just bear with me and hopefully you'll get something out of it, because the point is at the end is I want you to get the message behind the story, because if I was traveling around the country just to tell my story, then I would be wasting time. It's on YouTube, anyone can go get it from anywhere in the world. So inshallah, we're going to begin at the beginning. I was born and raised in Greenville, South Carolina. And I was raised by my grandparents, because at a very early age my mother had stepped out and my father was working two jobs. So it was me and my grandparents. And my grandparents were the traditional conservative Southern Christian folk, as they say. They were very, very conservative in their ideals and their ideologies, in their ways. You know, as you hear about, you know, people being set in their ways, that was my grandparents. Like, we did it this way, and this is the way you did it every single day, and that was it. And we were very religious in the sense that we went to church on Sundays, we went to church Sunday evenings, we went to church Wednesday. And in Christianity, that's considered very religious. And it was not hard for us to go to church, and it was not difficult for my grandmother to drag me to church every Sunday, which as a kid is what they had to do, because the church was two houses down from our house. There was two houses and then there was the church. So it was not hard for them to drag me every Sunday. And I hated church as a kid because of the simple reason that, you know, we were brought up United Methodist. And Methodist is, for any of you know, it's very traditional. It's not like you think about like screaming and shouting in church and all that. No, you listen to the preacher, you sit, stand up and you sing, you sit back down, you listen to the preacher, you stand up and sing, you sit back down, listen to the preacher, and that's it. That's all that happens. And the pews, as they call them, or the chairs, are made out of wood. They're hard. You get tired of sitting there. You're fumbling around, playing with the money that my grandmother gave me to put in the offering plate, all of these things. That's what I remember from church as a very small boy. But the thing that I do remember enjoying about church was Sunday school. Sunday school is what I got enjoyment from, because went to Sunday school, you painted pictures, you know, of like Noah building the ark, you painted, you know, all these pictures of Moses splitting the Red Sea. You learned the stories of Moses freeing the children of Israel from Egypt. You learn the story about him splitting the Red Sea. You learn the story about Noah and the Ark. You learn the story about David and Goliath. You know, you learn all these beautiful stories in Sunday school. So this was basically, as coming up, this is what I knew about Christianity, was the stories that I learned in Sunday school, because I never listened to the preacher during regular service. So that was the only thing I knew about Christianity. So coming up, this was how it was. It was just the norm. And the conservatism in my house, just to give you an example, and about the level of conservatism, is, if let's talk about gender issues. Let's say when I became 12, 13, 14, and I started to actually, you know, notice females, and I actually didn't think they had diseases and wanted to run away from them every time I saw them. Let's say I wanted to have a girl over or something of this nature. It was so serious to my grandmother that I had to make an appointment with her, let her know this girl was coming to my house. We had to sit in the formal living room, which in the South, I don't know how it is here, but you have the dining room, then you have the formal living room with all the nice stuff that you don't go in unless there's company over. And my grandmother either had to be sitting in the same room with us or in the kitchen where she could see directly in the room. I mean, this is just how it was in my house. This is how my grandmother and grandfather were. They were very stern. They were very loving, but there were rules, and those rules were the way they were, and they did not change. So this was my upbringing. And I would say at about the age of 12, 13, 14, more along the age 13, 14, I started going to the Saturday evening youth services at my church that were for 12 and up. And the youth services were held in the gym, and they were totally different than church. At the youth services, you went, we played basketball, we played volleyball, we played dodgeball, you know, we played every kind of sport, and we ate pizza and cake and candy, you know, all the stuff kids like to do. And at the end, the youth minister, who happened to be my catty corner neighbor across the street, when I was 14, he was 17, he was the youth minister, so he would sit us down and give us a 30-minute lecture about Christianity, about something about God, doing, you know, he would give us a 30-minute sermon, and that's how the youth services were. And going to these youth services, I met some other people who went to other youth services. They invited me to Young Men for Christ and other things that were going on in South Carolina. And so I started to go to these different retreats and camping trips with them. And so that is when I would say that I started to become a Christian out of will. I became a Christian because I wanted to, not because it was something I was dragged to do. I started to actually want to be Christian. This is something I wanted to do. I made my own choice and my own decision to do it. So when I turned 15, I started going to high school. And when I was a freshman in high school, my best friend, who was the youth minister, was a senior in high school. And I remember we had a very close bond because I had not had my license yet, so I used to ride with him to school every day. And it was a big deal for me to be able to ride to school with a senior, especially since he had a brand new, or it was a brand new, but he had a restored 67 Mustang, which I've always been a fan of cars when I was a kid. So we had a very close bond, and we were very good friends because both of our parents were very similar. They didn't let us do much. So we spent a lot of time with each other. And when I became a sophomore, he graduated and started to attend Bob Jones University. I don't know if that rings a bell with anyone, but Bob Jones University is a very prestigious conservative Christian college in South Carolina. It's probably the most conservative college I've ever seen, because the Moody Institute is known as one of the most famous in this country, since Chicago. But Bob Jones is conservative to the point to where when it comes to men and women, like men and women aren't allowed to get caught talking to each other in a room alone if they're not married, holding hands on campus. The men had to wear button-up shirts or polo shirts tucked in with slacks or jeans. The women had to wear skirts, no jeans, skirts that came down to the ankle and a shirt that came to the wrist. And this was part of the guidelines for Bob Jones University. You know, you didn't party, you didn't drink, there was none of this that happened at Bob Jones University. And he started going there, and his major was textual criticism. And textual criticism probably doesn't ring a bell with anyone, and to explain it in detail would probably take another entire lecture. But just to give you a brief synopsis of what is textual criticism, a textual critic takes the ancient manuscripts of the Bible, the pieces of parchment that were found all over the world, and he has to learn Hebrew, Greek, Aramaic, Latin, you know, these languages that these parchments have been found in. And he has to take these scriptures and try to find out where they came from, why there are variations in the many different versions of the same parchment. Let's say you have Matthew chapter 1 from the Bible. There might be 5,000 different variant readings of Matthew chapter 1 in 6 languages. And so he has to be able to take all these and sift through them, try to find out why there's so many variations of the readings, and then determine which one is the original. And that's not as easy a task as it seems. You could figure, you know, which one is the oldest is probably a more original, which is not the case since there are no originals. You might have one parchment that is the oldest parchment of the group, but it might be a copy of 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 a copy with laden with mistakes. And then you might have the newest parchment in the series that might be a once over copy from an original, or a twice over second copy from an original. Therefore, it would make the newer parchment more original than the older one. So it's not a very easy field to go into. And he started studying textual criticism, and being that I was his best friend, I started studying textual criticism. Whenever he was, you know, doing his homework or research papers, you know, I was right there with him. Whenever he did a homework, he would always let me read it. Or when he finished his papers, he would give them to me. He would pass down all of his papers to me. Every textbook, when he was done with it, he would give it to me. I started to learn a little bit of Greek, a little bit of Hebrew. So I became, you know, started to become a layman's textual critic, and I applied to Bob Jones University in my sophomore year because it was a 3-year waiting process for Bob Jones. And when I turned 16, almost 17, my friend came to me one day and he asked me a question that I had never really even pondered upon. He asked me, he said, "Have you ever read the Bible?" And I said, "No, in church. I mean, yeah, we've all read the Bible in church. You know, your parents make you open it up and look at it." And at the Bible studies that I went to, Young Men for Christ, we did have Bible studies, and we'd read a few passages and talk for 2 hours about those few passages. But he's like, no, have you ever read it? You know, like you read a book beginning to end. I said, "No, I don't know anybody that's read, nobody that I knew had ever read it, beginning Genesis 1:1 to the end." He said, "So, but this is the inerrant word of God, as we are taught. This is our instructions on earth. Why haven't we read it? You know, why have we not read this book?" And I said, "You know, that's a very good question." And he gave me a challenge. Well, it was basically a challenge for us both. He said, "Let us start with Genesis 1:1, and let's read the Bible, and let's see what God says to us. Because this is the inerrant word of God, inspired to men, for instructions for us. So let us see what God says to us. If God can talk to the preacher through this book, why can't he talk to me?" I said, "You're right." I said, "That's very good." I had a lot of time on my hands. I wasn't really allowed to do much anyway after school. So I said, "Why not? Let's read the Bible." I was somewhat nerdy as a 14, 15-year-old, 16-year-old. So we started to read the Bible, and we decided to go from Genesis 1:1. And what we tried to do, this was the attempt that we made, was to not think of anything that we'd ever heard about Christianity, but to open the Bible, and let's say I just found this book in the desert, and read it and see what it says to me. Let it talk to us. So we started Genesis 1:1, and we started reading through the Bible. You know, we did some of it together, and most of it I did by myself, because I'm a very, very quick reader, so I decided to read a lot on my own. And as I was reading through the Bible, I started to notice the stories that I had heard in Sunday school. You know, you start reading Genesis, you read about Adam and Eve, we all know that story. You start to read about Deuteronomy, Exodus, you know, the stories of Moses, the story of Noah, the story of Lot and Abraham, and all these stories that I know. But I was surprisingly and astonishingly shocked by some of the stories that I read about these same people that I learned about in Sunday school. Just for instance, and this is a big testament to why Allah kept sending us prophets and why Islam was sent as a complete and perfected deen with the Quran. If you read about Noah in the Bible, there is the story about Noah saving humanity from the flood with an ark and all of that. There is this in the Bible. There's another aspect to the story of Noah that not many people know about unless they actually take time to open a Bible. This will not be preached from any pulpit anywhere. Is that the Bible says that Noah was an alcoholic. This is the Bible's portrayal of Noah, or Nuh alayhi salam, that he was an alcoholic, he was a drunkard. This is the word used in the Bible, that he was a man given to alcohol. And I'm a psychology major, and my field of specialty is mental illnesses, and alcoholism is one of those, is a mental illness. And I know from seeing alcoholism's effect on one of my close friends' parents, I know that someone who is truly addicted to alcohol, and if Noah lived for so long addicted to alcohol, he was seriously addicted to alcohol. It is hard for someone addicted to alcohol to hold down a 9-to-5 job working at McDonald's flipping hamburgers, much less construct an ark to save humanity from a flood that's never happened. So that stopped me for a moment in my tracks, and I said, "Noah was an alcoholic." You know, and It bothered me for a minute, because I said, things started popping in my mind, like, if Noah was a drunkard, how did he know God was talking to him? Because, you know, I've seen some people, they're alcoholics, you know. You were just asleep in my dog's food bowl the other night, drooling, and now you're telling me you were talking to God last night. You know, rationally, that would not make sense to me. That's like, you know, an alcoholic on the street coming to you and tell you God's talking to him. You know, he has no, this would give this man no validity. This man has no validity with anyone. So I didn't pay it too much attention. It caught me, but I said, "You know what? I'm going to keep going." Because there's one thing that you don't do in Christianity, and I'll tell you what it is in a minute when I started doing it. Then I came across the story of Lot, or Lut alayhi salam. And we all know the story of Sodom and Gomorrah in these stories, but there's another very twisted story in the Bible about Lot and his daughters. There's a story of Lot and his daughters in the Bible that says his daughters got him drunk one night and seduced him and committed incest with him. A'udhu billah. This is the Bible. This is one of the Bible portrayals of the prophets of God, the person who saved his family from Sodom and Gomorrah. This is the story that is in the Bible. So I'm catching myself again, like, how this is becoming a really bad habit that I'm seeing. This is becoming a bad recurrence that I'm seeing over and over again in this Bible. So, you know, after that I started, you know, speeding through some of the other mumbo jumbo to get to more of these prophet stories. And I got to the story, there are others, and there are some stories in the Bible that are not PG rated, period. They're not rated for talking anywhere. You know, you would need an 18 and up ID card to be able for me to even tell you these stories. So the one that intrigued me, that caught my attention the most, was of my most beloved story in the Bible, and that was of David and Goliath. That was my most intriguing story to me, because not only was, you know, it said that in the Bible that David was a very small man and Goliath was a very big man, and that was appealing to me because I've always been very short, and as a kid I was really short. So, you know, I said, this was a very beautiful story to me, just in its prose and in its concept of overcoming. And so I started to read about David. And there are very beautiful stories about David in the Bible. There are indeed. But there is one story about David in the Bible that shocked me to my core. And it's a story about three people. There's three people in this drama: David, Bathsheba, and Uriah. And it says that David saw this woman named Bathsheba, and she was one of the most beautiful women of her time. And she happened to be married to one of the commanders of his army named Uriah. But David on this day decided that he was not able to resist his temptation to be with this woman, Bathsheba, so he did. And he committed adultery with her. And knowing that he did this, the way that he decided to cover it up was he sent a letter to the generals of his army, saying that when the battle was fierce, for everyone to pull back and abandon Uriah, so that he would be killed, and when he dies, then he could have Bathsheba, no harm, no foul. So David went from being the slayer of Goliath, the hero for man, to an adulterer, a plotter, and a murderer. And so this is when I really caught myself and said, hold on now. Something's wrong here. Something's got to give. I said, because to me, God's prophets in my mind were people of example. People who I could follow as an example. Someone who was supposed to be the best of us, so that we could follow them and emulate them. And they're turning out to be worse than some of the people that you see on America's Most Wanted. David is somebody that if I only knew this about him from the Bible, I see him coming down the street, I'm going the other way and calling 911, because he has to have a warrant out on him for something. This is what I'm thinking in my mind. This man is not an honorable man at all. He killed Goliath, yeah, but he killed this other guy named Uriah to be able to commit adultery with his wife. So I committed the cardinal sin in Christianity. I started asking questions. This is the one thing you do not do in Christianity, is you don't ask questions, especially not about issues like this. So I went to my pastor and I started asking questions, you know, what's going on here? You know, pastor, there's a very bad recurring habit about these men in the Bible. What is the deal here? And I remember he told me the same thing that almost every pastor or every evangelist or anyone I talked to about this, same answer, almost like it was programmed. They would put their hand on my shoulder and say, Brother Joshua, don't let a little bit of knowledge wreck your faith. Because you're not justified by knowledge, you're justified by faith. And they would quote me verses like, lean not on understanding, you know, Paul's, we're justified by faith in Jesus Christ. You know, this is all, they would quote this whole line of thing to me like it was already pre-programmed, that they programmed in pastor school that people are going to ask you questions and here's the answer. So, you know, I said to myself, you know, I don't know, pastor, you know, this just seems kind of odd. He said, let me tell you something. What you're reading is the Old Testament referring to God's covenant with the children of Israel. And they were a different people, a very stubborn, crazy people. So why don't you move on to the New Testament? In the New Testament, you'll find the new covenant they were under with Jesus Christ. And I promise you things will change and be better. I said, okay, perfect. So I read all the, went ahead and finished and got to Malachi and then started with the New Testament. So I, you know, I opened the New Testament and I said, here we go. You know, let's start all over again. But there were a few things that I had learned from the Old Testament that I wanted to keep in mind when I started to read the New Testament. I learned, number one, that God was one in a unique sense. This is what I learned from the Old Testament, that God was one in a singular, unique sense. This is over and over and over and over very clearly in the Bible. God's nature is one. This is so clear through the Old Testament. And that he was very jealous about his worship. And every single time the children of Israel would turn to something else other than him, he would punish them and restrict their lifestyle. This is something that I learned. And it kind of, the similitude to me with how God dealt with the children of Israel was, and I hate to use this stark, contrast, but it's almost as if one of us went out, God forbid, I hope not, and let's say we went out here and robbed a bank. You rob a bank, you're going to jail for a long time. And every day when you wake up, do you think that that jail is going to look like the Hilton at LAX? No, I doubt it. It's probably dark, cold, bad food, orange jumpsuits, not nice people, the whole nine yards. And the reason why this is, and I know this now from studying psychology, is that this is supposed to be a stark reminder every single day when this person wakes up that you are in jail. This is supposed to remind them every single day you're in jail because you committed a crime. And we run this, not you. This is the message that is being portrayed to this person in jail. So when the children of Israel kept rebelling against God, he restricted their lifestyle. If you study Judaic law now, it is some of the most strict religious law you can find. All of the good things that we enjoy as Muslims, even when it comes to dietary laws, like the good parts of the meat that we are allowed to eat, they can't have these things. These are things that are restricted from them. Why? Because God, Allah, wanted to remind them every day that I am Allah. I am your God. You will worship me. I run this, not you. And I understood this from reading the Old Testament. This is a concept I had come across. So I started with the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And one other thing that I did when I started to read the Bible was, if you go to Barnes & Noble, let's say you go to Barnes & Noble and you take a book off the shelf, what is usually the first thing you look at? The title. Then the next thing, the author. You want to know the title and the author. What is the name of the book? Who wrote it? And if you do this test with every single book of the Bible, you get a title and no author. Author unknown. Or author is appears to be so-and-so. Or we derive that so-and-so possibly written this. You know, like, let's just say for Exodus, they say Moses wrote Exodus. Which if you read some of Exodus, he couldn't have written all of Exodus. Because the last part of Exodus is Moses' death, burial, and Joshua taking over the children of Israel. Now, unless Moses was a sure indeed prophet that was able to write things after he died, then he did not write these things. And so when you go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, I wanted to know Matthew who? Mark who? Luke who? John who? Because it's called the gospel according to Matthew. The bad thing is that no one knows. No one knows because no one penned their name down to these things. No Bible scholar in his right mind will tell you that we know for sure Matthew so-and-so wrote this, Mark so-and-so wrote this, Luke so-and-so wrote this, John so-and-so wrote this. It's not. It's factual information that we do not know who wrote these. So I was intrigued. I'm like, that doesn't, you know, why would somebody write this book that's supposed to be passed down over generations and people are supposed to, this is the inspired word of God to guide mankind, and nobody decided to write, pin down who wrote it. But anyway, I started to read it, and I started to notice things about the teachings of Jesus Christ. And they were not what I had learned in church. When Jesus spoke, he spoke of the nature of God. And when he spoke of the nature of God, it was the same nature of God that I found in the Old Testament. Jesus said many times that God is one. God is unique. He would even quote from the Hebrew Scriptures. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is but one. When he was asked, what is the greatest commandment? He was asked the greatest commandment. He said, the greatest commandment, and every Muslim should understand these two concepts. This should be nothing new to you. The greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your might, with all your strength, and then to love your neighbor as you love yourself. He said, the rest hang on these two, which we know in Islam we have rights of the creator and rights of the creation. So this was the concept that he was teaching. And He even said in 1 John 5:17, and this was more clear to me than anyone else, anything else can be, this is life eternal, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. And when you look at that in the Greek and the Aramaic, it is almost exactly to a T of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, now that I know Arabic and have understood that, very same similar statements. Yes, indeed, there were some implicit statements about that you could implicitly, if you took them and separated them from everything else, you could maybe derive that Jesus was trying to claim some divinity or something for himself. But I also know from doing psychology, and I did a little bit of law too, that an implicit statement cannot override an explicit statement. An explicit statement always takes precedence. So if Jesus said God is one, and he anagorically may have alluded to God being more than one, then the clear statement overrides that each and every single time. So this is what I found through the New Testament. And I also found that Jesus taught salvation. But his salvation that he taught was obeying God and following the commandments. This was his mode of salvation. One man asked him, "Good master, tell me how I can inherit the eternal life." He said, "Follow the commandments. Follow the commandments." He even, in Matthew, was so sincere about it. He said, "Whosoever shall follow the least of these commandments and teach men to do so shall be called the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall break the least of these commandments and teach men to do so shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven." So this I understood very clearly, that Jesus taught the same nature of God that was in the Old Testament. He taught that the salvation lied in worshiping God and following the commandments. This I understood. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were very clear about this. You know, there were other things, the only begotten Son, you know, but these things were not in red letters, so I did not give them as much weight as what I did to the actual words that Jesus Christ was saying out of his own mouth. So I read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. All of it was saying the same to me. I said, but, and I was thinking to myself, this is not what I was taught about Christianity. You know, you're taught that God is one in three, three in one, you know, all, one, one, one equals three, you know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Jesus died on your cross to forgive your sin, you know. And there was another thing that I noticed from the Old Testament, and this is a beautiful lesson to Muslims, because you're asked this all the time, especially when it comes to da'wah. And I never put two and two together until I learned Islam and then read the Bible one more time, is I wanted to know why the Jews wanted to crucify Jesus so bad. Why so bad? They could have just mobbed him anywhere and killed him on the street. It's not like he had clans like the Arabs that would have come and backed him up. I said, why didn't they just kill him? You know, why were they so strict and sincere to tell Pontius Pilate, you gotta kill him and you need to sanction it. We can't do it, but you need to sanction it to kill him. And now I understand it, was that Jesus had a mission, and that mission was to share God with the world. And Paul even kind of tells on himself in his book of Galatians as to why Jesus was meant to be crucified, or the Jews wanted to crucify him. Paul said that the crucifixion is the stumbling block for the Jews. And he explained in Galatians that Jesus Christ, and this is how he tried to roundabout explain it, was cursed for us, to remove us from the curse of the law by taking this curse upon us. For it is written, and he quoted the Old Testament, everything that hangeth on a tree is cursed. So I went back and studied the Old Testament and Judaic law, and I realized that people who were crucified, that was considered a curse upon them. You had to do something pretty serious to get crucifixion, because it was considered a curse from God. It was part of their law that when someone is crucified, that person is cursed. So wherever they buried these criminals, like in the graveyards in Israel, in Jerusalem, in Palestine, where they buried these criminals that were crucified, this was considered cursed ground. This was considered ground that you didn't go on and you did nothing here, because these people are cursed by God. So I started to put two and two together. That it's not that they wanted to kill Jesus, because they could have just killed him. They wanted to disprove who he was. This was their point, was to disprove who this man was. He said he's the Messiah. They wanted to disprove it, and they knew if you can crucify Jesus, he can't be the Messiah. He cannot be our Messiah if you can crucify him. And even if he is, if we can still force our crucifixion on him, then that'll detriment his message. So they understood this and knew this, and this is why they wanted to crucify him. And this is exactly why Allah saved him from it. This, because everyone asks you, why did Allah save him from the crucifixion? Because you cannot crucify. That was part of his law that he came to fulfill, that he could not be cursed according to this law. He said, I have come to fulfill the law. To fulfill it, therefore he couldn't be cursed according to it. And this is why he went to the Garden of Gethsemane and asked God to remove this from him, because he knew how detrimental this was to his message of crucifixion. So I began to see all of these things. So I started to read. I got to the book of Acts and started to read the writings of Paul the Apostle. And things went from this to this. It went from one way to another way. It went completely flipped, turned around. The entire teachings went from obeying God, worshiping God, following the law, to worshiping Jesus Christ and abolishing the law completely. Paul even wrote to the Galatians, "Oh, you foolish Galatians, why are you still following this cursed law? Jesus Christ came as a curse to remove us from the affliction of this curse." So I said to myself, but Jesus just said a few books before this that whosoever shall break the least of these commandments and teach men to do so shall be the least in the kingdom of heaven. And here you go, Paul preaching this gospel to abolish the law. So I even asked, what is going on here? So I started asking my pastor, and my pastor said, now you're getting into deep water. You know, now you're starting to question the New Testament. You really have some issues. You know, they even thought that I might be, you know, possessed and all kinds of things. So I had a very big conflict going on inside of me, and my friend took me to his textual critic teacher, his professor, and what this man told me probably wrecked my faith in Christianity. And I always say, I doubt he would be very happy me traveling around the world telling people that a Christian professor from Bob Jones University wrecked my faith in Christianity, but he did, because what I asked him was, what happened to all these contradictions? You know, in the Old Testament, there are many contradictions. If you study Hebrew language, you'll understand that when you read some of the Old Testament or the Torah, that there are some parts of the Torah that you can see is the most beautiful Arabic that you can see. The most beautiful Hebrew that you can see, just like when you read the Quran. It's very beautiful Hebrew. And then two chapters later, you'll see Hebrew that looks like a broken three-year-old who is trying to scribble some Hebrew down. It looks very colloquial, very dialectic. You can tell it's not the same person speaking. So I went and asked him about all this stuff I saw. And he told me, he said, what you have is a book written by men over centuries and centuries and eons and eons. And he says, and this book started as an original that was copied and copied and copied, and somebody added a mistake, and somebody came behind him and corrected that mistake and added two of his own. Someone came and copied it and skipped a line and added a line where it wasn't supposed to be. And then someone else came and copied it and took it to his country. And in order for it to fit well with the doctrine they were teaching, he would cross out a dot here or cross out a word here or change a word here so that it would fit with the theological ideas of this part of the world. And he said, and after all these years, you have a book now that is compiled from all of this, written by the hands of men that still have men's fingerprints left on it. And that's what you have. You have an imperfect book that is only perfected through faith. This is exactly what he told me, that this book is perfected through faith. You cannot perfect it textually. It's not a textually perfect book. Those who believe in it by faith. And so I said, here we go again with this faith thing. You know, I said, God gave me a brain for a reason. If he did not want me to use it, he would remove this reason and logic part of my brain out and replace it with more faith. So, you know, and I was of the opinion, though, you know, as the saying goes, my grandmother didn't raise a fool. I'm no fool. I said, I can't believe in this. You know, I mean, this book I've been taught is the inerrant word of God, and you're just telling me that it's a book of errors that's only perfect through faith. That's like me taking a 1982 Datsun all beat up and say, if you believe, it can be a Mercedes. If you believe. You know, that would make no sense. You can't take a car to the car dealership and say that. No, if you really believe it, if you look at it right, it's a Mercedes. So I said, no, you know, this is a book full of errors. And God's religion is perfect. If God has a religion, it's perfect. If he has a book, it has to be perfect because he is perfect. So I left Christianity completely. And I decided that I was, you know, I had learned some concepts from the Bible. God was one. You couldn't fool me of that. You know, I had also concepted that there should be nobody standing between me and God because He created me without permission from anyone. Therefore, I don't need to be taking permission from someone to go to Him. If I had to be forgiven for something, it should come from Him, because on the day of judgment, it's going to be me and Him alone. And I didn't know about God's prophets yet. You know, I had my doubts and persuasions about that. So I decided to start searching other religions. I went back to Judaism. I studied Judaism. I found the same thing that Jesus taught about two spiritual Jews that leave the law, and laws, Jews that were so caught up in the law that they left no room for spirituality. I studied Buddhism, Hinduism, Taoism, Confucianism, Wiccan, Bushido, you know, everything I could get my hands on, every type of ism or religion, I studied it. But there was one litmus test that I used for every religion. And when I saw, whenever I met them, or the people or whatever about this religion, I would always ask them, do you have a book? Do you have a book? Because another thing I had come to the conclusion of is that if your religion is true, you should be able to tangibly hand me something and show me that this religion is true. Give me something that I can see. I don't want to hear that faith stuff anymore. I heard that all my life, and it, look where it got me. It got me thinking I'm driving a Mercedes, running around in a 1982 beat up Datsun. I said, no, you have to show me. And I read the Bhagavad Gita, I read the Torah, I read the scrolls of Tao, you know, I read the code of the Bushido, I read the Wiccan book of spirits and spells and all that other magic stuff they have. And I read all of these things, and I found something very congruent with all of it, was that there were very same philosophies and teachings in all of these major religious books. They all talked about God and His nature. Most of them alluded to the fact that God is one, and that God sends messengers to us and people to us to teach us. But they were filled with a whole bunch of garbage, to be honest with you, that I couldn't logically, rationally believe. So at about the age of 17, just about the about 17, 17 and a half, I gave up my search for God. And I became kind of angry with God, because I said, here I am looking for you, and I can't find you, and it doesn't look like you're giving me any help. And I don't know how many of you know, but for a 17-year-old that is frustrated with God and the world, there's a lot of trouble he can get into. There's a lot of things he can do to put himself in predicaments when he's frustrated the world and had come to the conception that, you know, if there's a God that exists, then He doesn't really care about me. You know, that's a kind of a dangerous young man. So I started doing the whole partying, in trouble, going to parties, drinking underage, all of this stuff I started doing. You know, I'm a perfectionist at heart. So when I was a Christian, I tried to be the best one I could. If I was going to switch to being any other religion, then I was going to do that 100%. So you better believe when I went after the dunya, I did that 100%. And, you know, I was a martial artist since I was 15 years old. And even though it was only 2 years, you know, 2 years at 17, you think, you know, you're Bruce Lee. So I got into a lot of fights, got kicked out of school, had to go to another school, got in one fight, got arrested for a fight. You know, and there were a couple incidences that stopped this downward spiral, because I was on a very, very quick downward spiral that would, and I believe if I would have continued on that downward spiral, I would probably end up hurting someone, killing someone, or them hurting or killing me. And there were two incidents that brought that to an abrupt stop, like pulling the emergency brake. And the first one was a car accident that I was in. My friend and I were on the way back from Clemson University from a frat party. And we were driving up 385 in South Carolina. And we were both highly intoxicated. And I decided that night that he was driving. I decided to put my seatbelt on for the only reason that I kept falling over when I fell asleep without the seatbelt on. Because I didn't really believe in the seatbelt thing, because I said, if I'm going to die, I'm going to die. You know, that was the conception that I come up with. That if, you know, if it's time for me to die, it's time for me to die. I didn't believe in the whole tie in your camel thing. So I put on my seatbelt and I fell asleep. And the next thing I know, I remember waking up with the car shaking. And I woke up to grab my friend because I thought maybe he had fallen asleep. But when I woke up, the only thing I saw was the tree line and then the pavement coming right at my face. And the window smashing and the car flipping the whole 9 yards. And us landing in a ditch. And I remember getting out of the car. That was the first thing I thought. you know, I number one, I couldn't believe that, you know, you don't really think about, oh, you're alive. No, you just move. I jumped out of the car and realized that I had jumped out of the back of the car that wasn't there anymore. It was still in the median on the other side of the highway, and the front part of the car was over in the ditch. And I drug my friend out, who was knocked unconscious, and pulled him over to the side of the road. I had no injuries. I looked at myself trying to find what's missing, and there was nothing but a piece of glass stuck in my arm that I pulled out. And it just so happened that a state trooper was passing the other way because he turned around and came back. And when he came back, he asked what had happened. And the first thing he asked me was, did you see what happened? Because there was other people who had pulled over. So I guess he thought that I was a bystander because I started to walk towards him. He's like, did you see what happened? You know, where are the people? I said, yeah, I really saw what happened. I was in the car. You know, and he was like, you know, as they say, like the color drained out of his face because he was shocked. He said, how were you in that car? You know, and of course they took him to the hospital. My friend got arrested, DUI. But before he put us in the ambulance, he was a man of God because he looked at me and he told me, he said, young man, you better realize that you're on this earth tonight for a purpose. The only reason you're still alive is that God has a purpose for you. If not, you don't live through things like that. People without purpose, if you didn't have a purpose, then this night would have been your night. So you need to realize that. I said, this old man's out of his mind. You know, if God had been looking for me, he had the opportunity to get me a long time ago. So don't tell me about that God stuff now. So I paid it no attention. And about a month later, 3-4 weeks later, my friend and I, same two, he's on crutches still, we decided to go to New York City. We decided to just take off, drive to New York City. We didn't tell our parents where we're going. I said I was sleeping in his house. He said he was sleeping in my house for the weekend. So we drove to New York. And in New York, I remember going to the ATM to get some money. And in New York, they have these ATMs where you have to go in the little glass room to get your money at ATM. I don't know if they have that here or if any of you have been to New York. Now, alhamdulillah, you have to put your bank card in to go in there. But in 97, it was not like this. You went in, and it was almost like the game Mousetrap, because you go in, take out your money, criminal comes right in behind you. There's nowhere for you to go. You know, there's nowhere to run. So I went in, I took my money out of the ATM, and I heard the door open behind me. You know, so I turned around. You know, I thought somebody was coming in behind me. And there was a man who put a gun to my face. And he must have really, 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 really needed this money, because he didn't ask me anything. He didn't say a single word. I just remember looking at the gun in my face and him pulling the trigger. And it was a revolver. And to this day, I'll never forget that image in my head of seeing that little spindle turn and hearing that very distinct click of a revolver. And it probably could have been like a .32 snub-nosed gun like this. But when it was in my face, it looked like one of those like cannons that you see on the movies. And I remember when he pulled the trigger, I didn't think anything. You don't think anything. It just blank. You just go into this like shock of blankness. And then a couple seconds later, thankfully I had been doing martial arts. That might have helped me overcome the fight or flight syndrome, because all I could think was, go! You know, like myself kicking myself, like, what are you doing? Go! So I bum rushed him. We went flying. He went flying. Money went flying. Gun went flying. And I took off and went to the hotel and didn't say anything to anybody. We went back to South Carolina the next day. And I didn't say anything because we weren't supposed to be in New York. My grandfather would have killed me. If that guy didn't kill me, my grandfather would have took care of it. So I didn't say anything until about a month or two later. You know, I kept having nightmares about this same incident. I kept having night terrors from this incident. And so I told my grandmother about it. And she told me the same thing that the officer had told me. She said, you know, you have to realize that God has a purpose for your life. You're here for a reason. There's no, people don't go through the things that you've been through and still walking on this earth without a reason, and you're pushing the limit. This is what she told me. You're pushing the limit, really. God has something for you, and he wants you to get it, but you're pushing it. And she didn't tell me to go back to Christianity and study my Bible. Only thing she told me was that God hasn't gone anywhere. You just have not looked in the right place yet. And so I decided to put myself back together. You know, the car wreck, the gun thing, the getting arrested for fighting, like all of that, like really made me stop really quick and think, you know, that I need to get my stuff together. So I became somewhat, I became an agnostic, someone who believes, I believed in God with no form of religion. I prayed to God on the floor on my hands and knees, because this is how all the books of God, this is how the Bible, the Torah, the New Testament, the Bhagavad Gita, all of these scriptures that I ever read, they said that this is how the men of God prayed. And it was during this time that I did read one book about Islam in the public library, because I had never heard of Islam ever. But I remember I was looking in the religious section in the library at school, and there was a book about Islam, and or it was in the library, the public library, and I remember it was some title like "Why I'm Not a Muslim" or some, you know, one of these titles that was propagandistic against Islam, but I had no idea. So I just took the book and I read it, and I remember it said that Muslims, M-O-S-L-E-M-S, and any of you knowing Arabic knows that's a very derogatory word. A Muslim is someone who oppresses someone else. That's a very quick sleight of the pen that was used in the past for a very real purpose. It said that Muslims were people who worshipped a moon god named Allah, who lived in a box in the desert in Saudi Arabia, and they were oppressive to women. I remember there was a whole chapter about how they could have four wives and as many as they want, actually, because they could marry two, divorce one, get three more, you know, this whole, you know, and it said that, you know, I remember the one thing that really caught my attention was the whole chapter on jihad, where it said that Muslims were allowed to kill non-Muslims at any time, at any place, without discretion, and it was an honorable act, and not only would they go to heaven before it, but they would get 70 virgins on the way. You know, so I closed the book on Islam, put it back on the shelf, and marked off Islam off my little list of religions, and said, thanks, but no thanks, and if I ever see a Muslim, I am out. And I said, I'm pretty safe in Greenville, South Carolina. I had never seen a Muslim, ever. So I said, you know, I don't have to worry about running into no Muslims, thank God. So, you know, I started, you know, just worshiping. You know, I tried to just be a good person, you know, pray to God, ask Him for guidance, try to be a genuinely good person. And I remember what changed is when I met a Muslim. I met a Muslim who I had met a couple of times at school. We had went to school together, and I knew him, but I never knew that he was Muslim. And there's a couple of reasons why I never knew he was Muslim. Because he was African American, number one, and the book said that Muslims were Arabs. And number two, I didn't know, you know, I thought Muslims ran around, you know, marrying as many women as they want and killing non-Muslims. I didn't know that they could also be part-time drug dealers. So I didn't know, I never knew that this guy was Muslim. I didn't put two and two together. So we were at his house one day, and me and my other friend, the one that, you know, I got into a lot of trouble with, I'm trying to keep him out of trouble now. We were at his house, and we were debating something about religion. I forget what even the topic was, but you know, you had two teenagers thinking they know everything. And I was trying to explain something to him about the Bible. And that guy came in and was listening. He said, have you ever heard of Islam? I said, yes, I've heard all about Islam. He was like, okay, so what do you think of it? I said, what do you mean what I think of it? That's probably the worst religion I've ever seen on the face of the planet. He's like, why? And he's like, but I'm a Muslim. I was like, man, stop playing. You know, like, you're an African American. You know, he's like, so? I'm like, the book said you guys were Arabs. All the Muslims were Arabs. He was like, what else did you read in the book? And I told him, he was like, man, what in the, you know, what have you been reading? He's like, you need to go to the mosque for Jummah. He's like, he told me, he said, I'm not a good Muslim. This is what he said to me. He said, I'm not a good Muslim. I'm not even going to try to front and say I'm a good Muslim. He said, but I can guide you to some people that can tell you the real truth about Islam, because he knew about my story about wanting to find religion. And he said, you need to go to the mosque for Jummah. And I said, what's Jummah? He said, it's just like church with no chairs. And I said, I can do church with no chairs because in church the chairs were the worst part anyway. Because they had these hard benches that you sit on that are like this and are so hard. I said, that's good. You sit on carpet? Wow, man, every church should be like that. And I said, where's the mosque? He said, it's on Wadehampton Boulevard. I said, we're on Wadehampton Boulevard. I lived on Wadehampton Boulevard. I lived right off of Wadehampton Boulevard. He said, you know where Lee Road intersects with Wadehampton? I said, yeah, I live on the other side of that intersection. He said, it's right there. I said, no, it's not. There's nothing. There's a gas station and a church. He said, yeah, you know that church, the Evangelical Missionary Training Facility? I said, yeah, I used to take missionary classes there. He said, you know that building in the parking lot with the gold thing on top? I said, the gym? He was like, no, that's the mosque. Because I had always thought it was the gym because it was in the same parking lot and it was just rectangular with two glass doors in the front. And you could literally walk in between the church and the masjid and touch them like this. Anyone doesn't believe me, go to Greenville, South Carolina, look at the masjid. You can almost touch the both of them just like this. He said, yes, right there. I said, I've never, you know, at first I was shocked. Like, I've been living across the street from all these crazy Muslims all my life. You know, I said, I never knew. You know, and he told me to go to Juma, and I asked him what time. He said he would meet me there at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday. So I said, okay, I went on Friday. And I'm waiting outside for him. You know, I'm not going inside. That's not happening. You know, and I'm seeing all these people going in. And at this time, it was a predominantly Indo-Paki Arab masjid. Anyone who went in was not American, period. And I did not see even one African-American going there. And I did see one. And then when he went in, I heard him talking in a dialect that I realized he was probably from Africa. So I said, he's not American. So I'm not going, I'm waiting and I'm standing outside sitting on the church steps and the imam pulls up and parks right in front of me, who I had no idea he was the imam. But he got out and he asked me, you know, am I waiting for someone, this, that, and the other. And I explained to him. He said, oh yeah, we know this brother. You don't see him that much, but we know who he is. And, you know, he said, I'm glad you came. You know, he was a very, very nice, gentle young man. And he invited me into the mosque and I kind of wanted to wait on my friend. You know, but I didn't want, you know, at the same time, I didn't want to tell this man, I don't want to go in. So I went in and they put me in the back and gave me a chair anyway. And I said, I came to sit on the floor. And they gave me a chair anyway, you know, and all of these people are piled up in front of me. And there's no Americans here. And I'm starting to wonder, you know, if this is a setup, because it's starting to smell like a setup to me. Because I'm in my mind, I'm like, you've been set up before and this seems kind of like this. So, and I'm starting to think in my head, you know, scenarios, you know, a young mind at play. You know, I said, this other guy, my friend, he probably was in the same situation like me, and he probably made a deal with them to get out as long as he brought other Americans and tricked them into coming to the mosque so they could do their jihad after Juma and get their 70 virgins. So I'm sitting here, and there's all these people in front of me. And then there's a curtain with all these people behind me making noise, and I have no idea who's back here. So I'm stuck in the middle of this. I hear that it's some women, but I don't, you know, there's a curtain. I have no idea. So I'm like, there's something very odd about what's going on right here. I'm like, just let me make it. I'm starting to look for the exit. I'm like, you know, calculating how many people are between me and the exit. You know, I know some martial arts, so I said I'm going to hit a couple of them, and I'm out. And then the imam came, and I just now realized that he was the imam because he got up on the minbar, you know, and they started to call the adhan. And, you know, I said, okay, that man seemed nice. He seemed genuinely nice. So I felt a little more comfort. And then he got up after the adhan, and he started his khutbah. Inna alhamdulillah nahmaruhu wa na'a. I said, oh my God. I said, I bet you he's talking about me. You know, and he's being forceful, you know, he was getting loud and banging on the minbar, and he's pointing in my direction. You know, I'm like, oh man, I gotta get out of here really quick, you know. I said, well, I'm gonna take my chance with the women behind me, I'm going through the curtain. And then he started to, when he got done with his Arabic tirade, he started to explain it, you know, that verily all praise belongs to Allah alone, or God alone, and Him do we worship, and Him do we seek help and assistance. We seek refuge with Him from the evil that lies. You know, he explained what he said in Arabic, and it sounded to me so beautiful. It was very, very beautifully prose what he said, and I wanted to know where he got that. You know, I said, where did he get that? You know, because it was only about God and about the nature of ourselves. All of us should know that the beginning of the khutbah. And he quoted the three verses from the Quran. All you who believe, fear God as He should be feared and do not die. And instead of a state of submission to Islam, he was a very wise man because he translated everything. It was almost as if he knew I was there and translated everything for me. You know, and he, I remember to this day what the khutbah was about. And I don't know if he did it because I was there or if that was his already planned khutbah, but it's almost as if it was meant for me. The khutbah was that, the title of it was that the forgiveness of Allah is open to anyone at any time, at any place, no matter what, unless they have committed shirk. And the prose of the khutbah was a very long hadith, that all, some of you will know. And just to make it short, it was the hadith where the Rasulullah ﷺ met Angel Gabriel, Angel Jibreel, and Angel Jibreel was telling them to tell him that if the Muslims commit this certain sin, to tell them that Allah would forgive them. And every time he would tell the Muslims, they would say, okay, well then what about this sin? And he would go back and meet with Angel Jibreel, and he would go back and come back and say, tell him that Allah will forgive him for that. And this discourse happened, you know, for many different sins. And then finally Angel Jibreel alayhi salam said, tell them that Allah has said, no matter what they do, even if their sins are compiled, you know, like the oceans are from the east to the west, as long as they have not associated a part with Allah, tell them that Allah will forgive them. And I remember he told me that, or he said that, you know, that the door of repentance to God is open as long as you have not seen the angel of death or the sun hasn't risen from the west. I didn't really understand the sun risen from the west thing at that time. But, and he said that, you know, God's forgiveness has to come from God alone. And he, this was the whole premise of his khutbah, was on forgiveness and tawbah. And I was saying to myself, these are all of the same concepts that I had formulated through reading the religious scriptures myself. And I'm asking myself, where did he get this stuff from? You know, where did he get all this? And he started using names like, he used the name Ibrahim alayhi salam. He used the name Musa. And I'm like, he translated it to Abraham and Moses. I'm like, where did he, you know, where is he getting these? These are names from the Bible. I know these people. And so after this, the khutbah, they started lining up for the prayer. And I got apprehensive because everybody's getting up in front of me and blocking my exit from the door. And so I guess they one guy in the back saw me, and he, because I had to move back a little bit, he said, we're about to pray. And I said, pray to who? And he said, to God. I said, which one? And he said, the one that created the heavens and earth. You know, the same one that's in the Bible, you know, the only creator of the heavens and earth, the only God. I said, yes, I know him. And so the imam started to pray, and when he recited the Quran, I know it sounded very intriguing. I had no idea what it was. But then when I saw Muslims bow and prostrate on the floor, verses and verses of every religious book that I had ever read started ringing off in my head, that this was the way men of God prayed. And the first thing that I could think of in my mind was, this is worship. That's what I said to myself. This is not prayer, because prayer is asking God for something. These people are worshiping God. So I said to myself that you've written this religion off way too easily. I thought I was a much more open-minded person than that, and I was ashamed of myself that I had written it off with just one little book. You know, I had put all this studies into the other religions. I read this one thing about Islam and was done. So I went to the imam after Jummah. You know, he talked to me, and I would have to say that I was probably a little bit rude with him. And I've asked him to forgive me. You know, I saw him a few years later. I said, you got to forgive me for the first time you saw me. Because he started telling me, you know, would you like to know a little bit more? He had a very heavy accent. He was an Egyptian brother. Would you like to know a little bit more about Islam? He tried to give me some pamphlets. I said, no. I don't want any of this right here. I said, do you have a book? This is what I wanted to know. Do you have a book? Can you give me? He said, yes, we have a book. I said, it's called the Quran. I said, can I read it? Is it in English? Can I read it? He said, sure, you can read it. And then he tried to explain it to me a little bit, how it came by. I said, nah, just give me the book, because the book should speak for itself.